afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dr. John Belkowitz. I'm the Director of Research and Development Intelligent Concrete, where we specialize in making concrete do the impossible. Today, we're going to be talking about Concrete 101. This is module number one. We're going to be focusing on some of the most basic and awesome things with that great composite that we love. So, let's dive into it. We're going to dive into this magical world of concrete, starting off with my background, who I am, who we are, what we do. From here on out, we're not going to mention that again, but I wanted you to understand the team that you're working with, as well as the purpose behind everything that we're doing. And there's this overarching theme, this overarching idea of what we're going after. After that, we're going to dive into the objectives for module one, this Concrete 101, focusing on an introduction to concrete in all of its majesty, and then diving into these three big ticket walkaway items, the top three concrete questions, the raw materials that make up this composite, and of course, the properties of concrete, where we're gonna actually role play with some horizontal concrete elements, if you will, and go into some of the properties that you would expect, and then set us up for module two through a concise summary. So without any further ado, let's jump into this presentation. I said my name is Dr. John Belkowitz. I've been in this industry since I had a full head of hair. I started in the United States Air Force in a civil engineering squadron. Really gave me the basis of a foundation for the need of new and emerging technologies that are scalable. And going through the Air Force Academy and different institutions, I was able to see some of the amazing concrete, innovative technologies that get lost in a university basement because there's not that conduit, that technical transfer that takes it from book to lab to real creep. And that's what we specialize in, and that's what Whitney and I created somewhere around a decade ago, was that environment for us to bring new and emerging technologies to save the world with all the concrete in it. So the ultimate purpose of not just module one, but the whole direction that we're taking with the United States Air Force Academy, the cadets, and this junior engineering concept is to make a concrete that is stronger, that lasts longer, and helps us fight and win wars. And there's a deeper conversation that goes behind slabs that you see in front of you, where we see this joint of our concrete slabs where they meet up. Normally you have, you know, more of those deleterious materials, whether it's your chloride-based de-icing salts and brines, or just water, or raveling, more physical attack from the processing of that concrete slab before it's used. We often see wear and tear, and oftentimes see something called foreign object debris, which then can cause foreign object damage, especially on a lot of our Air Force assets. So the overarching purpose of this is not only to give you, you know, engineering background, some place to see, you know, concrete, how it's made, how we can put it together, how we can make it stronger and last longer, but also create a concrete that doesn't have to be replaced as often, that a concrete that has a lower maintenance cost and an easier maintenance schedule, so we can get to our mission essential objectives and not waste time maintaining our concrete airfield pavements. So why do we care about concrete? One thing that you're going to see in these slides is death by PowerPoint. We wanted you to be able to print this out, walk away with it, and use it as a resource later. And even at the last slide, you're going to see a whole list of references of other great papers and resources to dive into to get a better understanding of this awesome composite material. But why do we use concrete? First and foremost, it's the most versatile, durable material that really meets the economics and the demand of the construction industry, and that's why it's been at the base of foundations of civilizations throughout time. Now, concrete can be molded into any form or any shape used in any type of construction, whether we're looking at bridge decks, whether we're looking at foundations, infrastructure, structures, multi-story construction, dams, locks, levees, spillways, even plates, pitchers, and fermenting vessels for wine and beer. There are so many diverse ways we can use concrete. The greatest part about this material is the imagination and the ability of the contractors is really the limit of what we can do with this material. With new and emerging technologies, we're able to use concrete in ways that we can only use other materials like steel and timber and some plastics. Concrete is a simple material to use, but it is so very complex. And I put this on this selfishly for me. You can spend your entire life learning about concrete and still only understand a little bit about it. It always have a certain mystery to it. It is a composite material. There's this wonderful definition by Holland Klein that was published back in 2003, and it's this composite material book. It really doesn't have much to do with concrete, but they define a composite material of made up of at least two constituents. In many cases, a strong and stiff component is present, often embedded, elongated form embedded in a softer constituent, forming the matrix. Now, extending that over to concrete, we have our softer matrix being the hydrated cement matrix, and our rock and sand being that stiffer aggregate embedded in that softer matrix. And what we're trying to get out of this is this, you know, the best of both worlds. We're getting the strength, the durability out of our rock. We're getting the gluing nature of our cementitious matrix, and putting them both together, we get a strong and versatile economic material. And concrete is made out of, it can be very basic and it can go very complex, but here we see this composite of the concrete constituents where we have a certain amount of binder, and that binder is made up of a combination to include Portland cement, other cementitious materials, whether they're secondary or supplementary. And then we, of course, have water and air, and then our chemical admixtures, and that makes up a binding matrix. Then we have this granular skeleton that's made up of either just a rock or sand, or a combination of not just different sized rocks and sands, we call them graded envelopes, but also steel fibers and other components, bells and whistles as I call them, used based off of the end need. We're going to get into that in other modules. Now, diving in from this majesty of concrete, the more introduction, I wanted to take the first portion of our Concrete 101 of this module to answer the top three questions that we hear in the concrete industry. Whether it's a junior or even senior engineer, we oftentimes hear these three questions from folks who have been working with concrete for a very long time, whether it's the academic environment or that real world or the operational world. So what is the difference between cement and concrete? I spent a very, very long time trying to figure this out. My father asked me this question. I really didn't have a good definition, and this was about a decade plus ago, maybe two decades ago. And I finally came up with a beautiful analogy, and I can't remember the exact word used to describe this thing, but flour is to bread as cement is to concrete. And flour is not bread, and cement is not concrete, because you need other materials to turn it into the end product, and plus you need a curing or a maturation process or a maturity process. Not only do you need that for bread, it goes from a doughy to a baked end product. Same thing with concrete, it goes from a fresh state, a green state, to a hardened state. What is the difference between concrete with a capital C and asphalt with a lowercase a? Well, first and foremost, the real name of both of them, Portland Cement Concrete, PCC, and ACC, Asphalt Cement Concrete, those are the two names. The primary difference is both of them are a composite material. Both of them have granular skeletons. Both of them have a binding matrix. It's just, what is that binding matrix made out of? And with asphalt, we're using that asphaltic binder, these PGs plus all these different, you know, chemicals and fillers that go into it. And with Portland cement concrete, we're using a cementitious binder. And the chemical reactions to make them, the raw materials, obviously are different between the two. Also, when it comes to asphalt, traditionally, it doesn't last as long as concrete. Concrete will also normally be a little bit more expensive, but it doesn't have that built-in obsolescence, that built-in returning of jobs because it's constantly falling apart that you get from asphalt. Number three, why do we care about water and concrete? Water is the necessary component to kick off the kinetics of cement hydration, but water can also cause problems if we put too much water of excess. And the difference between the two, there's water that we need for hydration. Anything over that is water of excess, the water that we use to get that flowability, to get that concrete, that gray concrete, down the chute into the formwork. If we use too much water of excess, we start diluting our hydrated cement matrix and creating a softer concrete that is not resilient to physical and chemical attack. And that's the reality that we have to deal with, that the cheaper we make our concrete, if we're in a harsh or even maybe not a harsh environment, but an environment where we use that concrete, whatever, a lot, it'll deteriorate faster because it's a more dilute or softer hydrated cement matrix and then concrete composite. So those are our top three questions. I'm not even saying good afternoon. We just had to take a break to go grab some lunch. So I'm excited to get back into this. We're into the Concrete 101. It's the second portion. We've just gone over the top three questions. Now let's look at raw materials. Now please bear in mind, we're not gonna spend too much time on raw materials because the different modules that we're gonna have are gonna focus on some of the individual raw materials. But the first thing that we use in our Portland cement-based concrete is Portland cement. Now officially, our Portland cement is gonna be governed by ASTM C150. Now within that ASTM, there are six different cements. And I think there's only five in that last one that white cement actually fits in the type 1 through 5. So these different cements are going to be used not only throughout the industry for different needs, but then when we look at these different cements, they might be used not just based on the end result, but also where we're located through our continental United States or just globally. Some places we might need concrete that's more resilient to hot temperatures. Some places we'll need a cement that's more resilient to hot temperatures. And then we'll need a cement that is more, in some areas, more resilient to sulfates. So all depending on the type of concrete that you're making, where you're working at, you're going to use these different types of cements. Now outside of that, the cement component that we're going to use in our binder matrix, we can also use other things. And those other things we fit under the category supplementary cementitious materials. Now there is a whole slew of them, both hydraulic and pozzolanic, and we're going to use those one as byproducts, products that are cheaper, or I should say less expensive than that Portland cement, not only in cost, but also on our environment. And more so, these products generally will make our concrete stronger and last longer. And the whole impetus of what we're doing, one of the products or the product that we are using in our research endeavor, is one of those supplementary cementitious materials, or supplementary cementitious materials that fits under a new category for nanotechnology. Really excited to talk about that. Of course, we also are using coarse and fine aggregates, everything from our sands, our quarried rocks, our river sands, to our limestone fillers, our recycled glasses, anything that can be used as a hardened particle surrounded by the softer matrix, we're going to consider part of our granuloskeleton or our aggregate composition. Now, in our mix, we're going to be using a coarse and fine aggregate, something that we find here, a river rock with a maximum size of 3/4 inch, 57/67, and then, of course, our concrete sand per ASTM C33. Admixtures, oh! We are going to make a cocktail, a Tom Cruise cocktail in dreams. And while I do want to dive into this a little bit more deeper, I'm just going to give you a general look. There's going to be two basic types of admixtures that we're using. One that fits under ASTM C260 for our air and training that we have to deal with for our severe freezing and thawing cycles. And the last one, the ASTM C494, covers the gamut of admixtures that we're going to be using to include water reducers, as well as the colloidal silica technology that we're going to be taking advantage of. Oh, reinforcement. Now, I love concrete reinforcement. As a matter of fact, I've been a professor teaching reinforced concrete basics all the way through the advanced, and it's one of my favorite things. So It turns out in this type of project, we're not going to use the traditional number four bar spaced 12 to 18 inches off center. We're going to be using dowel bars, slip dowels, did I say that right? At our joints between the different slabs that we make up. That being said, there are so many different types of reinforcement out there to include the reinforcing bars that we use traditionally, as well as steel fibers, plastic fibers, glass fibers, and of course, carbon nanotubes and carbon nanofibers. And then there's also silica nanofibers, silica nanotubes, and alumina-based ones as well. All right, ugh! This is my favorite. Now, I'm not gonna go into mixed design right now. We have another entire module that you can watch here in a moment that covers mixed design. So what I wanted to do here is role play. I wanted to look at two different types of horizontal concrete elements, a conventional concrete slab and then a higher performing concrete slab, and identify the differences, especially when we look at talking about the concrete fresh and hardened properties. So let's get into that role playing. We're gonna start out at a residential concrete slab. Now, I say residential, this is lower performing, commodity-based concrete. What we see here is a portion of a slab that is being replaced in a church parking lot. Now, the concrete that we're using here, or that we replaced, was 30 years old. As you can see from the surrounding concrete of this slab, there's not a lot of wear and tear to this concrete. It's holding on to its surface finish. We're not seeing any spalling or tearing out or flaking or anything. This concrete has done a great job staying in place because where it's at is taken care of very, very well. So we need a conventional concrete. Somewhere that's somewhere between 3,500, 4,500 PSI. We see a nice level grade so we can go a higher slump. Somewhere between a 4-6 inch slump. And because we're in the great state of Colorado, we have to deal with moderate to severe freeze-thaw durability. So our air, according to the Colorado Department of Transportation, has to be somewhere between 4.5% and 7.5%. And we want to make sure that that concrete is creamy and dreamy, but not off of a rich man's golf course. So we want to make sure there's a good binder matrix that will hold onto the water so the bowl floats will slide easily across the surface, but we don't want to put too much cement in there, not only to cause an expense to our end user, but also an expense to the environment because of all the cement we're putting in there. This is going to be an easy mix to make, somewhere around 517 pounds total cementitious, 1,250 pounds of sand, 1,750 pounds of our coarse aggregate, 5767. Like I said, we have to use 4.5% to 7.5% air, or that's how much air we need. So we're going to use an air and training agent around half a fluid ounce to a full fluid ounce per hundredweight. And because we want to drop our water cementitious down, to make this mix as strong as possible, we're going to use a mid-range, and even in some cases, a high-range water reducer, albeit at a much lower water or a much lower dosage. And our water cementitious ratio is going to be anywhere between 0.42 and a 0.47. All in all, this is an easy and fun mix to make, but it is definitely not something that we're going to use on an airfield pavement. The biggest reason is because it's not going to see the heavy traffic loading, nor is it going to see the repeated fatigue cycles from planes taking off and planes landing. So while this is an easy and awesome mix to create, it's definitely not the mix that we want to use for an airfield pavement. All right, so our next one, I call it either a bridge or an airfield pavement. The thing is, it's a higher performing slab mix that's going to see more wear and tear, more vibration just from use, as well as de-icing salts and brines because of the type of traffic that it gets. Now, in this situation, we're looking at a bridge deck. Now, this is an off-ramp, and that sea of green that you see is the epoxy-coated rebar. Now, based off of all the steel that I see in here, I can see there's a need for some columns. The congestion of steel tells me that the concrete that has to accompany this can't be a conventional residential type mix. It has to be that higher performing mix. So I'm gonna look at somewhere around 700 pounds of total cementitious. My rock and sand are gonna drop down to meet that weight. So we might be 1,200 pounds of sand, 1,600 pounds of rock. I'm gonna use a much lower water cementitious, anywhere between a 0.37 and a 0.40. I still have to use my air and training agent at a half an ounce to one fluid ounce to get my 4.5% to 7.5% air. And because I have such a high congestion of steel, I might not use that large of an aggregate. I might only use a pea gravel, especially if there's another cage under it, because this is just such a wonky area that they're placing it in. I can't really tell from this picture, but let's assume that the steel is spaced well enough. I'm gonna use that 5767. I have my cement, I have my sand, my water cementitious. I'll use a high range water reducer here, somewhere between 5 and 7 fluid ounces per hundredweight, and of course I have my air and training agent. What that's gonna get for me is a possibly more flowable mix. If I need to stiffen it up for a machine placement, I can go ahead, either back out of my water, I can back out of my high range water reducer, and I can even play with my aggregate to paste ratio to pull paste out, put more aggregate in to make it that stiffer mix for a slip form paver that might be used in this type of construction. All in all, comparatively with this type of mix, I'm going to have something much stronger. Now, this mix design, Haley, correct me if I'm wrong, this mix design, as well as the first one, they're in our PMXDB. Mm-hmm. So they're gonna get number 16, is what you wanna look at for that practice mix design number 2. So you wanna look for number 16, and Haley will provide that link for you. PMXD number 1, that more conventional slab, that's in PMXDB number 1. So, we're gonna wrap this presentation up with concrete properties, and gosh, there are so many properties that we're gonna get into. We're not gonna focus on fresh properties today. We're gonna be talking about some of the hardened properties and durability, because that's a major component of what we need to talk about. But please bear in mind that these properties are all used, not only in the lab, but also the field, to ensure there's a certain quality management or a quality control and assurance of the material that we make at the plant, we deliver to the job site, and then we put in our formwork. So all of these tests are used to identify if we're selling is what the end user is getting. Now, we're not doing this just to meet our engineering specifications. We're also doing this to ensure a certain service life. Now, the ones that we're gonna talk about with fresh properties, we'll do that in another module. What I wanted to focus on today was compressive strength and flexural strength. And growing up in the industry, everybody listening to this video, watching this video, knows that compressive strength is our bread and butter in the civil engineering world, especially when we're designing concrete structures. We can use compressive strength to understand or manipulate that number to get flexural strength, modulus elasticity. There's a lot of values, even splitting tensile and tensile strength, even though I don't necessarily agree with that. That being said, that ASTM C39, that compressive strength of concrete cylinders, is the most important number or value when we're designing concrete. Now, second to that, especially when we deal with pavements for airfields, is our modulus of rupture, or our flexural strength per ASTM C78. Now, both of these are very easy to generate. You're either making 4x8 cylinders, or you're making 6x6x21 beams. Cure them up for 3/7/28 days and break them according to these ASTMs. Very, very easy. With those values, we can do some great things. All right, I just wanted to summarize this presentation before we wrap it up. I wanted to give you a background of who we are and what we do. And I wanted to give you a light background. I didn't want to spend too much time, but it's important for y'all to realize that we are the technical liaisons for the industry, bringing new and emerging technologies to save the world with all the concrete in it, so you can fight and win wars. I wanted to give you the purpose of this overarching goal, which I just reiterated to you, and then back that up with our class objectives. An intro into what is concrete and why do we care, and then go into those top three questions, the raw materials, and of course, finishing it off with the properties of concrete. I gotta tell you something, I am excited to get into the rest of our modules. Haley, what do we have, 9 modules in all? Mm-hmm. And some of them are just absolutely awesome. This one is chock full of information. We're gonna get you these PDFs, so there are things that you can walk away with, things that you can review, and please don't hesitate to ask us any questions. The last slide that I got is a bunch of references. There are some great books and articles here for you to read, for you to dive into, to understand this seemingly simple yet complex material. Thanks for joining us today. Go concrete!
Beat asphalt!